Bonjour, je suis Alain Gignac, responsable des études à la faculté de théologie des sciences et religions, qui va devenir le 1er mai une composante de la faculté des arts et des sciences. Donc, on va rejoindre le département de littérature. Alors, nous allons avoir le nom, le titre de Institut d'études religieuses. Alors, bienvenue chez nous. Et je dis aussi bienvenue au professeur Fabrice. C'est pas moi qui vais le présenter parce que je vais plutôt laisser la parole à Marcelo, mais je tiens à souligner que le professeur Fabrice, depuis plusieurs années, est membre du comité scientifique international qui est chargé d'évaluer et de nous donner des conseils quant à la qualité scientifique de notre revue théologique. Alors, c'est une revue qui porte un S pour le pluralisme qui traverse la théologie, et c'est une revue dont la spécificité est de publier des numéros thématiques, ce qui est parfois un casse-tête éditorial, et une revue qui veut être en dialogue avec les sciences humaines. Alors, notre intégration à la Faculté des arts et des sciences, finalement, va dans ce sens-là aussi, d'avoir plus de contacts et d'interactions avec littérature, avec histoire de l'art, avec philo, histoire, etc. Anthropologie aussi et sociologie. Alors, tu peux vous présenter peut-être?
Très volontiers. Donc, j'ai déjà fait un premier test hier pour présenter M. Eliano Fabrice. Donc, je vais être meilleur aujourd'hui pour présenter la quantité et la qualité de ses réalisations et de son parcours de recherche. Eliano Fabrice est le titulaire de la chaire de philosophie morale à l'Université de Pise. Et ses intérêts de recherche sont et ils vont de l'herméneutique philosophique à la philosophie morale, justement, à l'éthique et éthique appliquée, en particulier éthique de la communication, et en particulier la philosophie des religions, dont sujet sur lequel il va nous entretenir aujourd'hui. Dans ces domaines, il a été, par exemple, le directeur de l'Institut des recherches religion et théologie à l'Université de Lugano et a écrit plusieurs monographies. Donc, parmi ces trentaines de monographies, il y en a plusieurs qui sont dédiées à des questions de philosophie de la religion. J'en cite juste quelques-unes. Une de 98, Tre domande sul Dio, trois questions sur Dieu, théologie et philosophie de 2004, et plus récemment, mais ce ne sont que des exemples, il peccato originale comme problème philosophique, le péché originaire comme problème philosophique, qui était donc publié en 2014. Je te laisse la parole, Adrien, je te remercie beaucoup.
Merci beaucoup pour la présentation, Marcelo, pour la présentation. Merci beaucoup à vous pour cette invitation. Je suis très content de faire la connaissance de la direction de la revue théologique et de cet institut pour les sciences religieuses. Je m'excuse parce que je ne parlerai pas en français, je préfère l'anglais parce que mon français est terrible. And then I will speak in this occasion about a situation, a paradoxical expression we well know, spes contra spem, a Latin expression, but a paradoxical one, I said, hoping against hope. What does this expression really mean? Well, may the paradoxical situation inherent in this expression apply in the contemporary context of old and new forms of religions? This is my question. Because I will consider, I will discuss old and new forms of religion, point of view of the temporal perspective. And I tend to explore the questions in my speech. But first of all, some history. Spes contra spem. It's a widely known expression taken from Paul of Tarsus, Romans 4:18. It refers to Abraham, who did not lose trust in God nor love for his son, although the situation seemed hopeless. The expression is usually taken to mean hoping against all odds. In the Vulgata, the passage reads, qui, ed est Abraham, contra spem, in spem credit. Martin Luther translated it as, hat geglaubt auf Hoffnung, wo nicht zu hoffen war. The King James Version has, who against hope believed in hope, but last but not least, the Italian translation of the Bible reads sperare contro ogni logica speranza. This logical hope. How can there be hope when there is no hope at all? It is a kind of hope made possible through an act of trust, of reliance, of faith. But not faith founded on belief. Besides, a faith characterized by strong motives and good reasons, on evidence and reasoning, the doxastic belief, in fact. Rather, it is faith that perseveres in trust, a faith that requires to go on believing even without a reason. It is the attitude of a person who refuses to see his convictions adulterated, falsified. This is the attitude of those who, in spite of all else, place their faith in and their relationship with God above all other things. And here we see the firm bond between hope and faith. Hope is not only sustained by valid reasons. There is a type of hope that holds out when all reasons for hoping is gone. And in spite of that, lives on through faith. This hope is plain to see in the story of the sacrifice of Isaac that Paul of Tarsus refers to. In post-interpretation, faith is at the core of the relationship with the divine. Faith is apparently the foundation on which hope rests. Faith makes hope possible even when all seems lost. Luther, and later several Protestant writers, principally Kierkegaard, was to develop this subordination of hope to faith to the point of affirming faith's independence and its primacy. But the expression of spes contra spem also enables us to highlight a particular aspect of a present-day religious situation. Here's my thesis. Whether we are speaking of traditional religions, especially those where reference to the future is central, as Judaism and Christianity, or new forms of religious experience, there is an ever-growing risk of a religious human beings losing their relationship with the future, with that which goes beyond the present. In other words, there is a risk that the required conditions for hope disappear. Here, I shall attempt a description of the situation through a brief analysis in which I intend to show how loss of hope in the monotheistic religions arises from the emergence of a fundamentalist perspective, whereas in the new religions, it is because the future is being absorbed into the present. And finally, I shall attempt to demonstrate how, under these circumstances, the only way for a further dimension, the prospect of transcendence, to be recovered is to build spes contra spem, even when hope itself seems to have been shattered. I shall begin by briefly referring to Judaism and Christianity. In both these religions, the relationship between God and human being is centered on an open-mindedness towards a dimension of otherness made possible, in fact, by hope. There is hope because of the tension between the situation human being lives in and what he or she is promised away, him or her. Human expectation of a better, fairer world, a divine promise. Same from this perspective, it is easy to understand why there can be hope when there is apparently no room for it. In this case, faith in God and belief in his promises is fundamental in comparison to all other relationships. And so with faith, it is legitimate to hope even when there is no reason to do so, even when one's experience of life and history do not justify it. The problem is to maintain the correct balance between faith and hope. Both are seen as keys to achieving transcendence. But today, this balance risks becoming impossible. Nowadays, hope is in danger of being swallowed up by faith, and the future risks being annihilated by the present. This is the present-day situation. And the consequences of this attitude are dangerous and unacceptable. As in the past, but more than ever before, in the present situation of a religion, the supremacy of faith over reason risks transforming religion into fundamentalism. Of course, the danger of fundamentalism is inherent to any religion. Fundamentalism holds that the relationship of the faithful with God is immediately guaranteed, is established here and now as truth, and as such, excludes any other type of relationship. The fundamentalist believes that the immediacy of his relationship to God makes it impossible to criticize it or even simply to discuss his convictions. In the face of the fundamentalist, the only choice is between being assimilated or to fight. This can be verified, for example, in Islamic fundamentalism. The literal interpretation of the Quran links the believers, the Muslim, since the subjugated literally, to the dimension of the eternal present. This eternal present is anchored to the time past of revelation. It is a definitive revelation, which for this reason makes any looking forward to the future futile. The future is merely a repetition of the present. It always depends on the past in a constant adherence to the past. In the future, nothing new is contained. But we encounter the same attitude, albeit in a different form, in the Hebrew and in the Christian tradition. Let us consider just one example. In Kierkegaard, for example, Avraham closely resembles a fundamentalist because, as Kierkegaard observes, Avraham's relationship with God is ruled by faith and by faith alone. Beyond all reasonable doubt, beyond any hope, that the person can still have. So, in these religions too, there is a risk of sliding into fundamentalism, a risk of losing our future in favor of the present, the risk of losing hope because of a particular interpretation of faith. But it is not whole. If we look closely at the wording of Genesis 22, we see that it proposes an alternative interpretation of the Abraham story. Not only does Abraham believe, Abraham hopes. He hopes against all hope. He continues to hope even when it seems that God has asked for his eldest son in sacrifice. He hopes against all hope because he knows that he must not disobey God's command, but he hopes in the face of a command from God himself. He hopes in spite of his faith in God, in spite of the blind obedience that God exacts from him. In the end, Abraham is right to hope. He's right because he looks forward to the future. The sign that this future is still possible is the respect for Isaac's life. He is the son from whom future generations will descend. Is a right, Abraham is right, because faith can never become an absolute. Faith cannot be separated from hope, and hope cannot be subordinated to faith. Hope reaches beyond faith and looks forward to the future. And faith can develop into trust, into confidence, only when it is animated by love. So, hope is our way of understanding that faith by itself cannot have the last word, but has to be part of the wider context of relationships. Hope looks toward the future, towards possibilities, toward relationships that can arise beginning from a faith that the believer in his present as in God. And love equates this relationship, the relationship between present and future, in the best way. Love is, in fact, a fruitful occasion for creating new relationships. In short, hope sustains this excess in the faith relationship, a relationship that in the fundamentalist demands exclusiveness and immediacy, but which on the contrary requires mediation. Hope is what makes room for this mediation between God and human beings. It creates a footing between the two levels and is an antidote to fundamentalism. It is open towards all the other loving relationships practiced in the world. After this point, I have discussed hope in general, addressing it above all from a theological standpoint. But we have to define this term more clearly. I'm a philosopher, and then I have to do this from a philosophical point of view. We must discuss the term hope from a philosophical viewpoint. We are seeing that hope implies a relationship to the future and an act of mediation. Mediation is this. It's important for us. Kant, Immanuel Kant, for example, makes it quite clear in its critique of practical reason. Kant says it is mediation between the always finite and limited human dimension and all that which is needed, aspired to by mankind, but which he or she are unable to represent and even less possess. In Kant's world, we can make regulative but not constitutive use of it. Kant calls the entirety to which the mankind aspires the summum bonum. It is the union of morality and happiness. It is not a given. It is not something we can experience at first hand. We only know of the summum bonum through our need for it. Thus, hope is the intermediate between our situation in our daily life, where those who do good are not always or only very rarely happy and accomplish a perfect world governed by God's justice. For Kant, hope has the capacity of opening up the world we live in and letting us say that the injustice we see in this world never had the last word. Hope in mankind is the expression of an excess that runs through our daily lives and our knowledge of reality. This hope, therefore, it says, enables us to overcome the destructive or adverse aspects of our daily existence and perceive a horizon of totality, of completeness that makes sense of what is negative. In this picture, God is our guarantee not only of the possibility of what we aspire to, but also its certainty. This, then, is how hope intervenes in Kant's moral philosophy. It is a function of transcending experience. That which manifests itself as present is not the whole picture of reality. The hope for future is this background of totality that enables us to give meaning to the present. So, the only possible answer to the famous question that Kant asked himself, for example, in Logik Jesche, is what can I hope for? Is the question. And the answer is everything. Everything. However, in contemporary philosophy, this very transcending the present made possible through hope is accomplished in a way quite different to that developed by Kant. Because today, hope is no longer necessary in anticipation of totality. There is no mediation. Today, those who hope often do not know who they turn to in order to obtain what they yearn for, and it is not to be taken for granted that they see their goal in terms of totality, perfection, completeness that will make sense of it. Today, those who hope often only hope to take a step forward from the situation from which they hope to escape. They hope for a way out, even if this escape or this way out may not be present itself. In other words, nowadays, hope is not necessarily hope for totality. We see it, for example, in Levinas' thought. In his Yathul reflections, in the essay de l'évasion, Levinas speaks of evasion from a totality, considered as something incumbent and with its ilia paralyzing our idea, our life. And in Totalitarian Fini, Levinas radically criticizes the idea of totality and Hegel's interpretation of it, not Kant's interpretation. He conceives of knowledge as having the same structure In fact, desire runs through knowledge, and desire is desire for the infinite. Thus, the content of desire goes beyond what knowledge itself can understand. Knowledge is modeled on hope. So, for Levinas too, hope establishes mediation. But this is realized, desire being able either to anticipate anything, nor certainly guarantee totality. Hope in Levinas is in fact hope for a gift. In other words, if today the traditional monotheistic religions are facing fundamentalism, it is because they may lose their dimension of hope. In many, too many cases, they are lost in the present. They are preoccupied with worldly things, with their own privileges, with institutional questions. Or they remove the tension between what is already and what is not yet. They abdicate from their task of finding intermediation between the given present and the future promise. And so they become fundamentalists. Fundamentalists leave their certainties in an eternal present against all hope. They have nothing beyond that, no future. They feel no need to go beyond because they experience truth only in the present. And although they believe in an eschatological fulfillment or in a promise of totality, all these fulfillments are already defined to the letter in the holy text and guaranteed by forms of behavior that leave space only for obedience. In the present, for a fundamentalist, the future collapses because fundamentalists have no hope. They only have certitudes, and their certainty of being in possession of totality, of truth, does not allow them to live in the mediation of hope, in the tension towards the future. But today, this situation is not only confined to traditional religions, nor only to monotheistic religions in particular. We see an analogous situation in the so-called new religions, principally in those connected to the so-called new technologies. By new religions, I mean those where the relationship with the divine is experienced immediately, beginning from humankind's specific needs. For example, the various forms of New Age religions, in which assorted characteristics of traditional religions are clubbed together with newly invented elements to respond to the need for salvation here and now of the person who turns to these religions. On the one hand, of those syncretistic religions propagandized by many gurus, and on the other hand, of television preachers and, for example, Scientology. If we look closely at these forms of worship that not everyone would agree to call religions, we see a total flattening of time. There is no past insofar as they are new religions. And even the future does not exist, insofar as what must be established is at what point the future becomes the present. For example, the moment when the end of the world will be on us. Everything is functional to the satisfaction of the individual who joins this new religion in his present situation. Thus, the future collapses again into the present. The present is to be lived as intensely as possible, thanks to the instruments provided by technology. And this is very interesting. I would like to give a specific example of this situation by discussing new ways of worship on the internet. Generally speaking, religious experience is present on the web in three main ways, in three patterns. Primarily, the internet is considered mainly as an instrument, a means at the service of particular contents, serving to communicate them effectively. In this perspective, it is used by traditional religions to announce, spread, and celebrate their faith. The example we can refer to is the Vatican, the site of the Vatican, www.vatican.va. This is one, a very simple site. It's a very simple site, clear, informative, many links all over the world. Where is Vatican City, and so on. It's an informative site, simply. It's quite interesting. And you see. But better, more interesting, there is a second form, another form of religious experience on the web. Not only a simple instrument, but an experience in which the content themselves of the religion are modified by the use of internet. See, for example, this religion, the Falun Gong religion. This is one of the most widespread religions in China and all over the world. But there is no place for religions, or better, for this religion in China. And then the connection between the persons, between who practices, who can practice this religion, is possible only through internet. Falun Dafa org, with its related links, what is the Falun Gong, for example, the exercises that is necessary keep or maintain the psychophysic balance, and the books, the main books of this religion. The connection is failed, but we can see the address site. In this second model, we can see that the forms of religious practice change in a virtual space. The myths and rites change. The ways of living the religious experience change. This is possible only by connecting on the web. But finally, the third model, in the third model, this process is well defined and completed because religions are not only technological religions, but they become, above all, religious technologies. This means that there are not only religions that make use of technological instruments to spread the word, but also there are religions that modify their contents by using new technologies. In the technological religions, religious experience is replaced by virtual forms of experience that take on a religious connotation. The internet favors the birth on the web of an authentic experience of what is sacred. The web, the same web, is something sacred. But here, unlike in the past, sacred does not indicate a characteristic of the world or nature, nor does it stand for mankind's behavior being governed by specific divine commands. Rather, sacred is the environment of the web itself. It is the whole virtual reality that receives an aura of sacredness. For example, the matrixism, the four tenets of the matrixism, belief in the prophecy of the one, acceptance of the use of psychedelics as sacrament, recognition of the semi-subjective multi-layered nature of reality, adherence to the principle of one or more of the world's religions until such time as the one returns. Or another, the Jedi Church. It's true, not a joke. It is true. For example, this is an official, and there are the commands shops too, of course. But Jedi doctrine. There are basic concepts, question and answers. Is there a deity? Is there? Perhaps the deity is the force. But this is a good question for Jedi to meditate on. Do we believe there exists a deity or deities who has had their own conscious and who can act on their own free will? We can meditate. Well, as I said, everything is living in present in this web or movie religion. What counts is, in fact, simply to connect now. Now, everything is available online, virtually, right at this moment. There is no room for the future, no room for hope. Ask for, from both New Age religions and religious technologies, is for them to provide immediate satisfaction, now, for the human beings' needs. The web is able to guarantee all this because on it, everything leads back to an eternal present. On the web, past and future end up by being transformed into a virtual present. On the web, everything is present. Altogether, everything is available virtually. This means that the possible, what we can expect, the realization of the future is already real, albeit only virtual. This means that the past too is never definitively over and gone, simply because we are able to live in it virtually, in the present, as in many role-playing games. In this way, through the infinite potential of web connection, it becomes eternal. And for this reason, it offers a prospect of salvation. But it is salvation, now, here and now, without future. Ultimately, salvation without hope. The loss of hope. This is a feature of modern day religions. It only belongs to traditional religion, often present today on the global scene in a fundamentalist version. It is a feature that marks new religions in which new technologies are able to transform everything into a never-ending virtual present. In this situation, human beings risk being permanently rooted in the moment that they are living in. They risk missing the chance of reaching beyond the finite condition that defines it in the search for completion beyond. They risk living escapism as a purely virtual experience. It is unable to transform the world and enable justice to triumph in it in reality. The situation outlined is then one in which there is no place, I repeat, no place for hope. However, it is precisely in this situation, that a new meaning for the expression space contra spam emerges. As I already observed, there is no space for the future. At the most, either hope loses its value, or it becomes subordinate to the faith, or is changed into something virtual. However, in reality, against these eclipses of hope, against this transformation into a caricature, at the exact moment in which all seems to refer to an eternal present, in the exact moment, we can still hope. Truly hope. We can hope in a real future against any transformation of the real into virtual. We can hope for a revelation of the is to come against any fundamentalist idea of a truth that has already been and is forevermore revealed. In spite of all, we can hope. We can hope against all false hope. Indeed, hope, true hope, is not necessarily subordinate to faith, nor guided by faith. It is open to relationships that go beyond our present life, that go beyond our pure and simple relationship with God and all living beings. This hope is inspired by love. In fact, only with love we can experience time. Love and time are close connected. Time. The possibility of taking on the past, even through forgiveness and through care and attention for the present and the relationship with that better future that hope enables us to cling to. Thank you very much for your attention.
To ask the first question, so I do it now too. My question is,
about something we were speaking about yesterday too, so we keep on the same conversation, and it's about the relationship between time and space.
Mm.
Because actually, yes, you were describing this structure of the hope, which is kind of a bridge or a broken bridge between present and,
okay.
and future.
Broken bridge.
And I mean, you were citing Levinas, and for Levinas, the idea of the acrony is fundamental in order to understand this bridge, this broken bridge, if you want, this bridge which is a bridge and a gap, and so which allows otherness. Otherness is possible in the future because the future is not linked to the present with a too strong link. There is a link, but this link can be broken. So hope is possible because of it, and otherness is possible because of it. So I was wondering, what about an idea, and you know that I would ask a question like that, what about an idea of the atopy? And I'm thinking about another space, not only another time, but another space, the space of the promised land, for instance, the space of I'm not of this world. But if this, and so hoping with spes contra spem, because there is a rupture, there is a gap, there is a broken bridge between a space and another space, which is parallel, but in this sense, I'm thinking about the promised land, but one could think also about the virtual space. So, you think something about that?
Our new technological world in the cyberspace, in the virtual space, space is not only something that we can experience at the same way, in the same way in which we experience the space of everyday life. It's okay, another space, but not in parallel with the everyday space. It is not another space in the meaning of the future can expect. This another space is present. We can experience this flourishing of many, many possibilities in which we can live. This is our situation today. Now we can live. And then the idea of time change, radically change. I think there is no special time because there is no more space. There are many, many spaces, real, virtual, another. Time can be connected not to space, but only to ourselves experience. What is our experience? It is not the experience of the other, like Levinas, le temps de l'autre. We are human beings that are characterized by possibilities. And this character is our temporal feature. It is not diachrony, the term of Levinas. We can see discrepancy. Our identity is criticized, is at stake. Our not only narrative identity, but a widespread identity in many, many spaces, in many, many worlds. We have to think about this temporal idea, starting from our self-experience as possibility and not as identity. There is no past, present, and future, in my opinion. There is our gone, this discrepancy is our future, connected to the going on of other persons in a network. And this is a past to which we have to interact, and you can experience all now. This is the present, the coincidence of occasional possible encounter between or among us. But you can read it in the fourth chapter of my book I gave you.
Thank you very much for your quotation. And I was really happy with your interpretation of Abraham.
Yeah.
You know, I am an exeget of Romans. And it's interesting because we insist too much always, maybe because of Luther, on faith.
On faith.
But faith is really not everything. And the link you made with fundamentalism is very interesting, and it's all the more interesting that because Abraham is a figure of the three monotheists religion, mm-hmm. religion, and could be a contrepoison or antidote,
mm-hmm. antidote,
you know, for the three religions, mm-hmm. Against fundamentalism. It was really,
I agree
with your analysis. My question would be, you say that religions, new ones and old ones, had lost the origins, you know, the hope. But it's all our Western culture. Mm. I have a political question, you know, the question of politics. It's really in Quebec. In Quebec, we don't have since 1995 our referendum, you know, mm-hmm. maybe. But there is no origins, no project. Mm. From one side or the other side, no? Mm-hmm. And it's only, the only political project is not a political project, it's neoliberalism. Mm. So I think that there is a link. We live in a Western culture where there is no future. Mm-hmm. And it's awful. And I read a lot, I don't know if you are close or if you have read Agamben analysis, mm-hmm. but what do you think of this kind of nihilism, or, you know, mm-hmm. to be on the side, you know, in the messianic time? Mm-hmm. Could you say something about your opinion about that? Or?
Yes, thank you.
And, you know, I want to hear you about the political consequences,
yeah.
of your analysis.
Yeah, thank you. First of all, I would say that in spite of these analysis, last century was the century in which philosophers were connected in the most way to an eschatological idea. Religious philosopher or Jewish philosopher, Christian philosopher, atheistic philosopher too, for example, as Bloch. But what is this eschatological idea understood? How is this eschatological idea understood? Only from a point of view of a possibility to wait for something new that can happen, an evenement. But this did not happen. I think we are at the same level, at the same time, of the people of Thessalonica between the first and the second letter of St. Paul. Between the first and the second. And I don't know if we can give today the responsibility of the fact that the eschaton doesn't come to the catechon, a force that retain something. We have no faith in the catechon today. And then from a political point of view, the consequence or better, the consequence in today's mentality, in my opinion, is the that we have lost the possibility to differentiate everything, what is good and what is bad, what is now and what is yet and what can be and what is not yet. Indifference is the term that characterizes, in my opinion, our Western world. And if all is posed, is put on the same level with differences, nothing has interest for me. Political consequences are very easy to see because neoliberalism, yes, the individual human being considered as individual, can be substituted without problems. Every individual is equal. That is, can be substituted. He has no importance in him or herself. Then, what can we do? I think we have to change mentality. It's my idea is that we can do many exercises for changing mentality, to activate new possibilities, new perspectives, new ideas, new or old. We have to regain our future from the past or from the present, but regain the possibility to think other scenarios, other possibilities in our life. Please.
Yeah, thank you so much for the presentation. You know, I was wondering, like, existentialist philosophers like Kant, you know, they usually state that this loss of hope of faith leads to isolation or loneliness. You know, for me, it was not clear where's the difference, you know, how come, you know, like certain people would become lonely or isolated and others would become fundamentalists, right? And when we speak of loneliness, it's very important to emphasize the emphasis of I mean, the influence of Buddhist thought on him, right? Because for him, the other is actually the absolute. It's not just the God of the Christian or Judaic tradition, and this desire, you know, for coming to know the other who's always present there. And additionally, it seems to be losing hope and having no mediation. But the internet, like, is a form of mediation. Like it, and I do not, I'm not familiar with all these interesting religious movements, new religious movements you presented, but they don't seem to me really fundamentalistic. I think just people are looking for, like nowadays, you know, for example, I used to call people, now I'm sending them an email, right? So I think something changed in the medium. Like these people, instead of going to a church or to a priest or whatever, you know, they just go to the internet and this is how they kind of, you know, express their desire for hope, whatever. But I'm just wondering, at least in South Asian traditions, when we talk about fundamentalism, we also kind of take into account the cultural identity, you know, colonialism, post-colonialism, because like Islamic fundamentalism, it uses the technology nowadays, like we think of ISIS, whatever, but it feeds on this kind of glory of the past, you know, this frustration with the West, you know. I'm not sure it's really the loss of hope, whether they don't realize there's no future, but I think there's something with, you know, this being marginalized, you know, others, being othered, being neglected, you know, and being left out, you know, as a process of the discourse of secularism. So I think this is very important because not every religious movement would produce like fundamentalists, you know, but even traditional religious traditions, you know, like evangelism or Islam for that part, or even Buddhism, you know, would, you know, produce people who subscribe to this really fundamentalist ideology.
I think that we have to distinguish two ideas of fundamentalism, two patterns of fundamentalism. The first is the so-called literalistic, legalistic fundamentalism. This idea of fundamentalism is connected to the past. The past is defined by a text, a revelated text, and this text is Word of God and can be only read, not interpreted, by accepted in its literal meaning. The past is something that must be immediately applied in the present. This is the idea of the literalistic, legalistic fundamentalism. Without mediation, the norms described in the holy text must be applied now in Canada or in Italy or in Saudi Arabia or in East Asia. Okay, but there is the second form, a charismatic utopistic or utopian fundamentalism. Many sects have this idea, but how can at first see I can recognize here an ideal future, but it is not a real, a true of future, because future here is only something that is revealed in the present by a guru, by a founder of this religion, this new religion, that has the charisma for being the chief of this movement, of the religious movement. And then, yes, you're right. We are living in the age of the internet. Internet is a net, a web, a Zoom, mediation. But structurally, internet is a mediation. The fundamentalism can be connected to the past, literalistic legalist, or to the future, charismatic utopian. Okay, this is a structure, but the question is, how can we connect, experience this structure? Answer, only in my present. And then this is the lost future and the lost of the past. Students didn't know his or her past. This is the reason because I said that we need to change mentality. Well,
thank you.
Thank you.
There's no other question? Sorry? Pas d'autres questions? Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.